Hello and welcome to the channel. My name is Dr. Sami Hajjaj, and today we're going to start a new program or new course, Automations and Robotics. And this is the very first session, Fundamentals. So let's get going. So today we will talk about a few fundamental topics and introductory issues that we need to understand before we can really get into the details of or the analysis of the robotics. So we need to talk about automation, what is automation, and specifically what is industrial automation. Then we begin to talk about robotics in general, what is robotics and type of robotics, etc. In later chapters, we will then focus on industrial robotics. Also, we will also delve into analytical approach such as kinematics, as well as robot programming and control. But for now, let's build some foundation. Let's just build a foundation of understanding and develop some form of understanding of some foundational topics, which will help us greatly when we delve into the analytical steps. So let's go ahead. So the first thing we talk about is automation itself or automation in general. The very name of the course is Automation and Robotics. So what is automation and why is it distinguished from robotics? So in general, automation is the creation of applications or the use of technology to produce and deliver goods or services with minimal human intervention. Essentially, you try to reduce your own labor as a human and then allow the process to perform on its own. And in other words, automate itself. And automation can be used in many areas where humans are involved, such as manufacturing, transport, utilities, defense, facilities, operations, and lately even in information and technology. I'm sure you've heard the story of that guy who automated his own job, so he doesn't really have to do any work. The software or the computer program that he wrote simply does his job for him, and he just chills and relaxes the whole day. And he did that for years. And that's very true, by the way. Anyway, so in our context, in this course, we will be focusing on industrial or manufacturing automation, which is the use of computers, information technology, engineering, mechatronics, engineering and science, as well as online resources to control industrial machinery and processes. So therefore, we can replace human operators and improve the quality and the value of the output of the completed product. Now, this industrial automation, as we understand it, the use of robots or machines, today is actually known as the third industrial revolution. So if that was the case, if this is the third industrial revolution, so what about the earlier revolutions? And basically, I'm sure you've heard recently as well, the IR4 or Industrial Revolution 4 or Industry 4.0. Well, let's put all of that into context. Obviously, there has been three earlier revolutions or earlier industrial revolutions. So let's talk about those for a minute. The first industrial revolution, or historically speaking, the industrial revolution, happened in the early or in the 18th century. This is came about with the development of the steam engine or the steam power in England around 1760 or 1820. Before that, manufacturing or production used to be manual, hammer, saw, anvil, and basically human power and human muscles. But with the development of the steam power, then comes mechanization. You have now machines that can do the work. Instead of sawing something by hand, the machine will saw it for you. Instead of hammering something down or change the shape of it, the machine will do it for you. And this industrial revolution really is a revolution in terms of production output. It has significant impact economically, socially, as well as politically. It really changed fortunes, created millions of jobs, made billionaires, and even created a new different classes of society. Now you have workers or the laborers and the owners or the industrialists. Now, today, this is called or known as the First Industrial Revolution. What is known as the Second Industrial Revolution happened in 1920 or in the 1920s when Henry Ford revolutionized manufacturing by introducing the assembly line. Before then, or before the concept of the assembly line, which is kind of normal for us today, manufacturing, even though it was mechanized, it was more or less a customized job. You put the product in one place, and then you bring all the workers and the machines and the equipment to it, and then you work on it. Obviously, you cannot do everything at the same time, so you'll have to, people will have to queue, and operations will have to wait, and so on and so forth, resulting in a lot of delays and a lot of costs. Henry Ford developed what's called the assembly line, whereby the production line itself is moving, and the products are moving along the production line. And then you have stations of workers, of equipment, of machines that are stationary. They're not moving. And then those stations apply their tasks, the welding area, the painting, the wiring, and so on and so forth. So this actually created what's called, this also led to a new revolution, because this actually led to a boom in production volume and quality. It also led to dramatic reductions in lead time, or the amount of time before the product is ready or produced. Also, it led to job specialization. You have people who are specialized in welding, people who are specialized in painting, people who are specialized in wiring. They don't do anything else. They just do this job, this particular job, and then focus on it. Around the same time, Thomas Edison introduced Nikola Tesla's AC current, and gradually electricity also replaced steam power as the viable source of energy. This was, some people also consider electricity as the source or the secondary source of this industrial revolution. And this led to great economical boom in the US in the 40s, well into the 60s. And that's why that generation, the generation that was born in that economical boom, are known today as the baby boomers. Okay, so now we move on to the third industrial revolution, which started in around by the 70s, essentially, in the 1970s. Although mechanization did great to reduce the labor or the amount of labor that human did, it was essentially very limited to what it can do. It still requires extensive human labor anyway to monitor, to operate, etc., etc. So by the introduction of, by the 1970s, with the development of computer technology and microprocessors and microcontrollers, the concept of cube computer network control computer network control machining or CNC machining was very much introduced. You see, in CNC machining, the manufacturing machine itself is essentially what is called an electromechanical system or a mechatronic system. The motion of the cutting tool is controlled by the controller or by the onboard controller, which itself can be programmed by the operator to produce any shape, any complex shape within its space limits. So all you really need to do is write the program that will generate the complex shape, and then the machine will do it for you. This was, again, a revolution in manufacturing, because for the first time we were able to produce very complex shapes that otherwise were impossible to make before that. And also CNC machining led to development of a few other new technologies, such as rapid prototyping, and in recent years, 3D printing. These are all sort of the offsprings of CNC machining or CNC control. Now comes the latest or the final or the current industrial revolution, which is the fourth industrial revolution, or IR4. And the fourth industrial revolution, the primary engine of it is information or data. See, putting it all together, mechanization, computer controlled, and then you have data, or you see the amount of information about the process, production volume, production quality, production specifics. All of this information is vital. And so with the development of the internet and capabilities of networking and speed, computer technology advancement, electronics and embedded systems, and in recent years, the Internet of Things, IoT, data analytics, all of that put together came together to call and to give birth to what is called the fourth industrial revolution. Big major part of manufacturing is the presence and the requirement of the need of the use of data or information. Managers need to use this information to, you know, to process operation, to utilize resources, to reduce waste, and to maximize productivity. IoT or the technology or all of the technologies mentioned above allow or facilitate the transfer of information and data extremely quickly and extremely with reliable consequences, and is readily available to the managers and manufacturers wherever they are on the planet as long as they're connected, and it doesn't matter what device they're using. This allowed, this information allows even small shops or large manufacturing operations to benefit and greatly benefit from IR4. It can bring about another major boom in production, in quality and quantity. And that is why the current fields of engineering or manufacturing is all about IR4. You have smart factories, connected industrial robots, IoT-enabled factories, and other related technologies. So it's very important for you as a mechanical engineer or any other student for that matter to get on board with this technology so that you'll be also benefiting from it in the future. We mentioned mechatronics before, so let's talk about that term in a minute. The CNC machine that we introduced earlier was the very first example of mechatronics or electromechanical systems. Mechatronic itself is a two words in one, like mechanical and electronics. Electromechanical system could also include electrical as well. Now, regardless what terminology we are talking about, the meaning is the same. You have a system that involves three different components. The mechanical components, such as the links, the joints, the cutting tools, the body parts, equipment. And then you have the electrical and electronic components, such as the controller that controls the motion of these mechanical parts. And finally, you have the software, which is the program that is basically telling the controller what to do. So these three elements, controller program, software, and the controller itself, electronics, and the mechanical parts, mechanical, are all put together, resulting in what we call today mechatronics or electromechanical systems. Mechatronics is everywhere with us today. It's in all of the fields that you can see in front of you, be it automotive, aerospace, medical, you name it. In every field that involves machinery, you must have one form of controller and therefore programming or another. And of course, robotics is essentially a mechatronic field. It's a mechanical system. It has a controller and it also being programmed. So a robot is an electromechanical system or is an example of a mechatronics system. So now that we talked about automation, let's focus a little bit about industrial automation or manufacturing automation. The two words are interchangeable, although some people argue that industrial is different than manufacturing. It depends on the context. Some people feel that manufacturing is a subfield of industrial. I'm not going to argue against all of that. I'm basically using the two terms interchangeably. So you might see the word industrial automation, you might see it manufacturing automation. I basically mean the same thing, which is the automation of machinery used in manufacturing. So this could mean a lot of things. This could be CNC machine, cutting machines, or machining equipment, automated assembly lines, assembly equipment, automated storage and retrieval facilities or systems, automated inspection systems, sorters or handling equipment, and of course, industrial robots. So these are examples of industrial automation equipment and machinery. So what's next? Let's now move on to the type of industrial automation. There are actually two major types of industrial automation, and they actually depend on the volume of production, or they are related to the volume of production. Fixed automation, or otherwise known as mechanization, is sort of the classical form of automation. This is where we have a machine that has been set up, the consequences of operations, the equipment that we're going to use, the machines we're going to use, we're going to use to produce the product. These are all have been already pre-designed, prefixed, and set up, and then they are now running in very high volume of operations. Because of the high investment cost and because of the high volume required, this system is quite fixed. Fixed in a sense that you cannot easily change the product. Let's say, for example, today we are building, or we are making product A, which is a bottle. Tomorrow we change our mind and we want to change the shape of the bottle. Unfortunately, this cannot be as a matter of just changing the program. Unfortunately, that doesn't happen. You may have to change the machine altogether or change the sequence of machines. You have to stop operations, reconfigure the whole system, and then run again. And that's why this kind of automation is referred to as fixed. And it's usually designated for mass production. You know that you need like millions of bottles, so you don't have time for programming. Just build it as fixed, run it, and you'll be good to go. Of course, it involves very high initial investment, but because of the high production volume, you should be able to recoup the costs or the initial investment costs. On the other extreme is the programmable automation. We know it as CNC machining, for example, right? You see, in this kind of automation, you obviously have the flexibility to simply change the product by simply reprogramming the system. You have your machine and it's producing product A. If you want to change the shape, no problem. Just stop the operation and insert the new program or modify the program and run again. But then again, this kind of equipment is also expensive, and that's why it also requires to, you know, it cannot be used for very small volume of production. It has to be considerably high as well, but not as high as fixed automation. That is why this kind of production is, or this kind of automation is suitable for batch productions. When you have batch A and then batch B, like product A, product B, but then they are both produced on the same production line. This is where it is ideal. So for the first 4 hours, you run program A, and then for the first or the second 4 hours of the shift, you run program B, and then you have two different or distinct products. This kind of flexibility is not available for fixed automation, as we said earlier, because that would require reconfiguration, resettings, or even different machines altogether. Somewhere in between comes what is called flexible automation, which is somewhere in between. It gives you some form of balance. This is where the production line or the production system has a combination of both fixed elements and programmable elements. And it gives you some room to maneuver or to some wiggle room, allow you to maneuver between the fixed elements and the flexible element, and the programmable elements. Examples of this sometimes include, like automotive, like you have the chassis of the car is the same, but then the windows, the front panel is different. So you may have to do some batch program there or batch production there. So regardless of the type of automation, the key element here is always the volume or the production volume. It has to pay back for the cost. See, manufacturing or factories, they are not social businesses. They are businesses. So their purpose is to make money and profit. So the product they manufacture has to be sold. And then from the profit or from the proceeds, you pay for your costs and then you profit. So if you don't have enough volume, then you cannot justify the cost of automation. And we will come to this point in a minute, in a couple of slides. So let's talk about the benefits of industrial automation. Of course, the very point of automation is to eliminate the dependence on human labor. And with it goes out all the problems associated with human labor or human factors. You reduce labor costs, improve worker safety by... You see, sometimes or some of the robots can do jobs that are hazardous to humans. Like, for example, very extreme temperatures, exposure to chemicals, repetitive jobs that would cause injuries. So all of that stuff, usually by not giving this or exposing this kind of task to humans, you improve their safety. And of course, you mitigate the effect of labor shortages. If the worker is not there, they resigned, or they are sick, or they strike, or whatever. So again, these are one of the benefits of automation. And then you reduce the or eliminate manual or clerical tasks. And of course, You can perform tasks not even possible by human. For example, you want to do a repetitive task that is extremely fast, that even a human hand cannot do it for at all, but cannot maintain that speed. Now, the production itself can be improved. Improved quality, improved manufacturing lead time, overall reduce unit cost because you can produce high volume, and of course, and also you can reduce waste and scrap, and of course, reduce inventories. These are all the great benefits of automation. But of course, nothing is free in this world, so everything has a price. So that brings us to the next point, which is the challenges of automation. Of course, when you use automation to reduce dependence on human labor, you are basically letting people go. And lost jobs, or if people lose their jobs, that will cause a number of socioeconomic problems. You have people not able to work, cannot provide for their families. This causes problems, social problems, economical problems. The buying power or the expenditure power of the population is reduced. This might even cause crimes or other problems and other social problems. So that is why it's not always rosy when you turn into automation. There has to be a conscious decision here, and you'll have to sometimes be positive about your relationship with the manual workforce. Also, automation could be dangerous. I mean, you might have an accident where a human worker got hit by a robot or by an automated machine, and it did happen, and it does happen. So, no matter how you best would try to be safe in the factory, there's always accidents and mistakes. But that's not all the limitations to robotics. Other limitations include the automation itself. The investment cost could be very high maintenance and service costs. The break-even might last for very long or many long years. I mean, you would need to recruit. You have to spend many years just collecting the investment cost back. You also need to have very highly skilled labor to operate and maintain the robot. You see, the laborers who train to handle a conventional machine, they just have to turn a few knobs. And yes, that involves skill, but that is different from operating a computerized robot, which would require knowledge in programming, in engineering, and in a number of fields, which itself require a very trained and very well-trained labor force. It would also require very reliable and high volume of production. See, to justify the costs involved, you must have a very high volume of production expected. If your production is low volume by nature, then you should not go for automation. And of course, automation or automated system in a factory might cause bottlenecks. If the operation itself is time consuming, like in order to make a complex CNC shape like the one shown earlier, this might take time. Like, for example, this particular shape might take a very long amount of time to produce. And if the rest of the production line is waiting for this part, then we have everything is basically stopped and waiting for this part to come. And that's the very definition of a bottleneck. So that's why automation in general is not a rosy way, and it's not perfect all the time, and it's not for everyone. That's why manufacturers or owners or managers, they will have to decide whether it's suitable for them or not. Okay, let's move on to the second part of this session, which is essentially introduction to robotics. And this is just an introductory to robotics in general. What is robotics? What is the word robot came from? And also an introduction to some different types of robots. So let's take a look at it. So let's talk about a little bit of brief history of robotics. See, since the dawn of human history, we were always fascinated with automatons. And an automaton was defined in before the 19th century. The word automaton was basically what we call a robot today is the word automaton. But in the past, that used to be different to what we understand I mean, the meaning of the word automaton was simply any kind of machine that operates on its own. And these automatons were very favored attractions in festivals, circuses, and any live performances. People were fascinated to see these machines run by themselves and do magical things like move a hand or open a mouth like a duckling here. And these were all entertaining to watch. And after the Industrial Revolution in the 18th century, scientists began to consider the use of automatons as a tool to further accelerate production and to alleviate the burden of humans. You see, at the time, at the 18th century, or the start of the Industrial Revolution, the conditions in factories were miserable, to say the least. Workers were really, really suffering at the time. So some scientists thought, well, why can't we just build a machine that can help in that, and rather than depend or rely or put humans into this suffering? And that was up until the 1900s, or until the beginning of the 20th century, until the writer Frank Baum wrote his wonderful book, The Wizard of Oz. And this book and the rest of the series introduced a couple of automaton characters that were actually part of the story. They were sentient beings that were interacting with the rest of the characters. You have the Tin Woodman and TikTok, who are integral part of the story, and they were essentially robots who are socializing with the rest of the characters. And this may sound to us today as normal, but back then in the 1900s, that was very new. It was for the first time you have a machine that is essentially being considered as a as a social or a sentient being. Let's move forward now to 1920, and the Czech playwright and novelist and journalist Karel Kapek, he wrote his play which was a very popular play called Rousseau's Universal Robots. It was he who introduced the word robot to our language or to our lexicon of words. The word robot comes from the word robota, from Czech or from the Slavic word robota, which means forced labor or do without question or just follow the orders. And that is the meaning of the word robota in the Czech language. So he used that to describe the person or the machine that does exactly that, which does the job, and that's called a robot. It's funny enough that today when we want to describe this behavior, when someone does the job without questions, we simply say, just do it like a robot. It's funny because the word robot itself means do it without questions. It's kind of a chicken and egg situation. Moving on to another. Now, around that time, this was what do you mean by social robots. Now, in the 1938, the very first industrial robot was developed. Essentially, it wasn't really a robot the way we understand it today. It was a crane-like mechanism, or something like a crane, really, a mechanism which uses a non-rigid mechanism or a crane-like mechanism that uses a camshaft system for motion control. So you have a single motor and then a camshaft and an elaborate mechanism to achieve the repetitive back-and-forth motion. And it's very, very similar to what you have learned in theory of machines, mechanisms, camshaft, and so on and so forth. So it was a machine that with a hand or with an arm that goes back and forth and no sense of programming and control. All you do is switch on and off and the machine goes back and forth to do its job. Now, in the same year also, the first humanoid robot or android was developed in 1938. And it's called Electro. And again, although this looks like a human being with arms and legs, but again, on the inside, it was an elaborate set of motors, gears, and mechanisms, and mechanisms essentially. And nothing to do with controllers or programming, because at the time, this concept or this technology, controllers, was not even developed yet. Now comes in 1940. And a huge development in the world of robotics with the publication of iRobot by Isaac Asimov. Isaac Asimov is a writer, and he started the science fiction series of books on robotics with the beginning of the book iRobot. I know there is a movie called iRobot. It's obviously follows the book, but the book itself was published in 1940. And in this book and the rest of the series, it was for the very first time the concept of robots were introduced to the general public. Before that, it was just scientists and engineers who were working on machines to help manufacturing. But for the very first time, the concept of robot, as we understand it today, was introduced to us. Isaac Asimov, in his book, introduced a lot of terms that are normal to us today. The word robot was also introduced, although it was used by earlier, like 20 years earlier, by Carol Capek, but in that play, while popular, it was not universal. It was the Isaac Asimov books that were translated to just about every human language. So the concept of robot and the science field that we call today robotics was also introduced by him, as well as the three laws of robotics, which were social robotics kind of thing, but the very concept of robotics, field of science, etc., these were all as a result of the works of Isaac Asimov. And from there on, there was a new generation of scientists and students who were fascinated by this field, and that led to the boom and of the development of robotics as a field. Now, we're going to move faster with the robotics development. The 1950s, the first programmable manipulator, the first concept of a controller and a programmer in the 1950s. This was, of course, after the development of microcontrollers, like 10 years prior. The first mobile robot, Shaky, was developed in the 1960s, 1961, I think. And in the 1970s, we have unmanned aerial vehicles, or drones, as we call them today, as well as the introduction of humanoids. Humanoids is, or as otherwise known as androids, not the phone, yeah. Android was used in the 70s to describe a robot that mimics the human body, walks like a human, even talks, or even responds to human input. In the 80s, we have direct drive manipulators for the first time. You see, before that, motors or the actuators were placed outside of the robot, and then you have a series of chains, gears, and mechanisms to transfer the motion. But for the first time, the motors themselves were directly installed onto the joints. And that's why the word direct drive. So you don't need to worry about chains and mechanisms, etc. Other development in the 90s, now we have collaborative robots or cobots. These are robots with sensors that can actually have feelings. They can collaborate with humans. Although this lovely picture here shows a futuristic hand robot, but this concept applies also to industrial robots. Collaborative robots actually, mostly today, is industrial robots that collaborate with human operators. But the same concept applies. They have built-in sensors, and therefore they can hear, they can sense or get some feedback or information from the workers as they do their jobs. So from the 2000s until today, from the 2000s onwards, we have social robots, social pets, dog robots, and we have the Roomba, the best friend for every household, which is the vacuum cleaner, which is a mobile robot that works as a vacuum cleaner, and all of that. In fiction, of course, I'm sure you're familiar with all of these characters, R2-D2, RoboCop, if you are in my generation, the Terminator, and of course, iRobot. As you noticed, you cannot see any of these robots, with the exception maybe of R2-D2, in real life, because these are all concepts or theory. The concept of robots attacking us all or killing us all, it's still in movies. Unfortunately, or maybe fortunately, the AI or the thinking process, it's not yet that developed. By the way, the R2-D2 robot, at the time of the movie in the late 70s, this was a very popular home device. which was not really a robot as the way we call it. It was simply, like a garbage tin on wheels, basically. And it makes some sounds and stuff like that. And it was really a fun toy. I don't remember it. I was too young. But I remember seeing it still in the 80s growing up. Okay, so the last part of this introductory session, which is the type of robots that we're going to be, that are out there. What are they? And which one of these types of robots you'll be working with? So the very first and foremost, and as you saw earlier, the oldest type of robot is the industrial robots, otherwise known as manipulators. The industrial robots are the devices used in, why they're called manipulators, that will be discussed later. But for now, let's just call it industrial robots. They're obviously used in factories, and they're not always manipulators, by the way. Sometimes we do have mobile industrial robots, but for now, the majority of, or let's say 99% of robots or industrial robots are manipulators. Humanoids are robots that resemble or mimic the human or even the animal bodies, whether in motion or even in human reaction or even performance. So you have this robot toy or robot pet, and this guy that looks like a human body, and you have a robotic gripper that is a humanoid gripper, and finally you have a social robot that actually can present or show some emotions. Then we have mobile robots, the next type, which is mobile robot. Mobile, as the name implies, that is able to move around. And there are two general types of the mobile robot. The first two that you see here are, we call it on wheels. Sometimes we call it a platform, a mobile platform. A platform simply means it's like a table, like almost really like a coffee table on wheels. And it has built-in sensors that allows it to navigate around and find its own way, either in a predefined path or using its own sensors or simply using remote control. And the reason for these mobile or moving platforms is the use in industrial robotics. They can be used for transportation, they can be used for many, or even for learning. And the other type of mobile robot is legged mobile robots, or as you can see, they are on legs. Such as this kind of robot, this particular kind of robot is called the hexapod robot. Hex as in six legs, as you can see here. Other variation of the hexapod is the spider robot, and this obviously is the dog or the pet robot. This is the early generation of the dog robot. Now it's much more powerful. But regardless of the motion or the type of, the way that the robot moves, they are all considered mobile robots. Some people consider this humanoid robot as a mobile because obviously it can move. Yes, we can argue that as well. As long as the robot can move from its own base on its own, then it can be considered as a mobile robot. Flying robots or unmanned UAV, unmanned aerial vehicles. That's the official name when it first came out. Somewhere along the way, somebody decided, you know what, UAVs is a very long and boring name, so let's call it drones. So the definition of a drone is essentially it's a mobile robot, yeah, because it can move. But it's not moving on the ground, it's flying in the air. And by the way, not just necessarily flying in the air, this could also be diving in waters. It's the same concept, just different medium. So this could be winged drones or propter, or you know, something like a helicopter drones. Or some of them have engines, some of them have gas engines, it's almost like a plane, but not that size. So these are also started in the 70s and up until today. And yes, that's it. That's the first part of, or that's the completion of the first session. So let's recap what we covered today. We talked about automation in general. We talked about industrial automation. We talked about or introduced the concept of industrial automation, the types, benefits and challenges. And we also talked about robotics in general and their types as well. And we also talked briefly, not really briefly, about the history of robots. In the next session, we will focus more about industrial robotics. We will delve deeper into industrial robots, different types, components, applications, and where are they being used. So until the next session, thank you very much, and I'll see you in the next session. Take care.